I'm gonna say, I need you.
Sabbath, everyone, on this beautiful Sabbath morning of November the 21st, 2020. We thank God for allowing us to see another Sabbath day. I want to thank all those who have tuned into this ministry, to this broadcast today here from the Magazine Street, Seventh Adventist Church, located here in Louisville, Kentucky. I want to say greetings to our church family, and to our community at large, and for those around the world who may be listening to this telecast and to this broadcast, this ministry. We thank God for you tuning in to hear the word of God. We, on yesterday, it was our privilege, well, we had to bury one of our beloved members, or at least have a service for him, Dr. Bernard Irvin Minnis Sr. And we didn't say goodbye to him. We didn't say farewell. We just said to him, we'll see you in the morning. Because for the Christian, death is only but a sleep. And we believe by God's grace and the power of the resurrection that we will see our dear beloved brother, Dr. Bernard Minnis, Irvin Minnis Sr., in that great getting up morning, not only with him, but all the saints who've died in the Lord. There's going to be a grand reunion. And so we do not sorrow as others sorrow, because we have that blessed hope, that blessed assurance. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home and we'll tell that story, hey, and how we overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. So it's good to be here to lift up the name of Jesus and presenting the word of God to you on this Sabbath morning. As you know, we have been dealing with a new series in this Preach Moment, three-part series under the rubric Come Before Winter, under the theme After the Election 2020, What Now? Last week, we were privileged to present to you part one message entitled Hollow Victory. Many thought that the Biden and the Kamala Harris victory was a hollow victory because we lost so much while capturing the White House. And we took a look, and we took a look at Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 through 14, and addressing a question, a very important question. The question was, who is worthy to open the book and the seal thereof? And John, the Revelator, wept because he thought it was a hollow victory because he found no one that was able or found worthy to open up the book. But one of the 24 elders tapped John on the shoulder and told John to get up. Hey. And he said, there is someone from the line from the tribe of Judah. That's a messianic title to Jesus. And from the root of David, who have prevailed to open up the book. And we concluded on last week's message entitled, Hollow Victory, that victory belongs to Jesus. Oh, what a word we had on last week. Well, today, God has given me some fresh bread to bring to you today as we do part two's message entitled, This Is Us. I want to use as a scripture to present this message today under the tutelage of the Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 1 Corinthians, the writings of the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth, chapter 1, and I want to use verses 10 through 17. whatever tablet you have, whatever device, whatever translation, gather your family around the dining room table, gather around the den, wherever you are in your bedroom, maybe you're outside, wherever you are, gather them around. Let them know that the preached word is going forth and you want them to hear this word that God has for them today. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verses 9 through 17 will be our focus. And we read these words from the writings of the Apostle Paul. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no division, there be no division, there be no divisions, there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For if it had been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, says Paul, that every one of you said, I am of Paul. Some say, I am of Apollos. Some say, I am of Cephas. Some say, I am of Christ. And then verse 13, he says, is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? And then he goes on to say, he says, I thank God that I baptized none of you but Cephas and Gaius. And then he says, lest any should say that I have baptized in my own name. And I baptized also the household of Stephanas aside. I know not whether I baptized any other. Then he says in verse 17, for Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be of no effect. I want to preach on the message entitled, This Is Us. This is us. Let us bow our heads as we ask God to guide us and lead us. This is a very delicate, a very sensitive, but yet a very important message that needs to be heard by everyone of the household of faith. Father God, we thank you this morning that you have allowed us to rise up to see another day. I pray now that you would amplify your word right now. Bind the devil from the premises. Let there be no witch, no hex, no distraction from the transmission of this word today, so that wherever it may be going out, people may hear the word of God. Hide me behind the cross that Christ may be seen and uplifted. And give me the power to preach your word. And when all is said and done, oh God, I will be careful, yes I will, to give you all of the praise, the honor, and the glory, because you're God all by yourself. For we ask it all in the word, the name of Jesus. And let everyone say amen. Even though I can't hear you, I need you to say amen in your household, wherever you are, to the word of God. Amen, amen, and amen. This is us. I want to draw some analogies and some parallels how divided we are as a country following this election of 2020. We have now come to break it down by calling ourselves blue states versus red states, rural America versus urban America, the suburb versus the inner city, Democrat versus Republican, white American versus black America, mask wearing people versus I don't want to wear a mask. Closing down rather than and those who want to open up. We are divided as ever before as a country. And here's the thing, brothers and sisters. Somehow, we were fooled or we fooled ourselves to believe that we had arrived, or the myth that we live in a post-racial society. And we believe that just because a black man was elected to be president of the United States, we thought everything was peachy cream and that all of us were getting along. We thought we were free from discrimination. We thought that we were free from prejudice because Barack Obama had been elected in 2008. And we felt good about ourselves as a country. But little did we know that when Donald Trump, in making America great again, he disavowed us of all of that notion that we are a post-racial society. We found out under Donald Trump, brothers and sisters, under his administration, how deeply divided this country is. This is us. Oh, when I say this is us, I'm not talking about that television show that comes on every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. entitled This Is Us, that heartwarming, fuzzy show that comes on every Tuesday. Jack and Rebecca, the Pearson family, you know them, and their multiracial children. I'm not talking about that show. And I had a chance to watch that show with my wife and my daughter and my son, Justin. And they love this show, but I had a hard time. I must be honest with you. I had a hard time keeping up with the show because it kept going in and out. I'm back in the years and so forth and so on. And you know me, I need you to stay focused. And so the show kept going in and out. And yet Carolyn and Courtney and Justin, and of course George wouldn't even have it, they would watch this show, This Is Us. And the show was warm and fuzzy and all of that. And you know, TV has a way of glamorizing things and make you believe that everybody is singing Kumbaya. And at the end of the day, everything is all right and lovely. But see, what we discovered, brothers and sisters, hear me now. The real This Is Us showed this ugly face 2 weeks ago on a Tuesday night in the presidential election. While America, 70 million people voted for Donald Trump. And we know what Donald Trump stands for. Everything that is divisive, everything that is racist, everything that is rotten, everything that is wrong, everything that separates us. That's what Donald Trump stands for. He's not about bringing people together. He's about polarizing people and making people be at odds with each other. And yet 70 million people voted for him. And yet we're still reeling in this thing, even though President-elect Biden and President Vice President Kamala Harris has won. Donald Trump is holding us hostage in the White House. Refused to give over the transfer of power. Like a little spoiled child. When he or she can't have their way, they take their toys and go home. And Donald Trump, right now, today, has this country at a standstill. Not only has he divided this country, but I believe that under demonic forces, he's trying to destroy everything good and decent about what we stand for as a country. Come on, say amen, somebody. Now, here's where I want to go at. It's not surprising to me when you study history that our nation has been divided. Even before the Civil War, even in Reconstruction, and even up to now, our nation has always been divided. And somehow we sweep certain things under the rug. But we've always been a divided country, particularly when it came to race and people and color. But here's what I want to bring out today. While America is so divided as a country, I believe this is why more than ever before, even though the country is divided, hear me now, we need a united church and a united family. Yes, the country is divided, but God's church should not be divided. God's people should not be divided. God's family should not be divided. That's why we ushered you in with that song. I need you to survive. You are important to me. We are a family. I do you no harm. I do you no wrong. We are part of God's family. That's what Hezekiah Walker says to us. So while the country is divided and in disharmony, God's people should not be divided. And so we come to this text in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verses 9 through 17. In our text, Paul is dealing with disharmony and division in the church. And we can only imagine, brothers and sisters, what that church must have experienced when Paul sent them a letter written to them about what was going on in their church. And let's be honest, because see, I'm going to lay it out there today. Anyone who has ever been a part of a church, whether you be Baptist, whether you be apostolic, whether you be Seventh-day Adventist, whether you be independent, whether you be a Methodist, whether you be AME, whether you be whatever ism you may be, if it's a church, you will at some point experience conflict and division will arise. Can I get an amen, somebody? And where sometimes people get upset with other groups in the church, or they get upset with a certain family in the church, and even sometimes people get so mad and are at odds with each other, they sometimes want to leave the church because of the division between them. Help me, Holy Ghost. And I will submit to you today, I'm not going to be long with this message, but it's a clear message that we need to hear. There are real biblical reasons when a person should leave the church. Yes, over doctrinal issues, when the church is not teaching biblical principles based on the Word of God, you are not required to stay at that church because they're not speaking the Word of God. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And if they speak not according to this word, it's because there is no what? Light in them. And so when we study the Word of God, it's line upon line, precept upon precept, and study to show thyself approved. A workman need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so when biblical truths are not being taught on a regular basis and a part of your spiritual diet, you are not required to stay within that church. But then there are times when people leave the church, not because of unbiblical reasons, not because of maybe the leadership, unbiblical examples of leadership, but there are those times, and that is with what's going on in Corinth, when people leave the church, where people get upset over things they should not get upset over. That's what's happening here in Corinth. You know, you've heard the saying, much ado about nothing. The people were leaving, had division in Corinth because they were fussing about that which really was not that important. You see, it's a part of our human nature. I'm guilty. You turn to your family member and say, they're guilty, you're guilty. We're guilty of this. People get offended as to something somebody said about them or things that didn't go their way. And whether real or perceived, Their pride is wounded or hurt by another. And see, when their pride is hurt and wounded or offended by maybe what somebody said or what somebody didn't say or whether what they heard somebody say, it creates division within the church. And then the devil uses that division. Hear me, brothers and sisters. He uses that division to set up a four-pronged attack on the people of God to justify their position. Number one, they start to keep records of the wrong of the person who they believe have offended. And then number two, they become righteous and indignant, believing that God has deputized them to purify the church. And then number three, they gather up others to support their views. And by doing so, they create factions in the church, division, disharmony, disunity. And then number four, vengeful protests against whatever they are opposed to. But hear me today, brothers and sisters, I stand on solid ground. All of this is very opposite of our Lord's command when the Bible says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you have loved one for another. Bear one another's burden. Forgive one another of his or her faults. That's the biblical mandate. We're not called to be divided among each other, to create division based on what we perceive we're not getting our way, or what somebody said or what somebody did. We are a family. And Paul makes it clear in verse 9, which is the basis for unity. Paul said, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his son, Jesus Christ. And so Paul is speaking to the church of Corinth. And when you read 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 2, and 3, he spells out more detail as to what they're arguing over. A lot of foolishness. And that foolishness causes division. It causes people to lose their way. And nobody gets the victory over that kind of situation but the devil. I'm your brother. You're my sister. We are a family. We are in the body of Christ. In John's Gospel 15, Jesus said, abide in me. And then in John 17, he said, Father, may they be one as we are one. There's no division when it comes to the children of God. Paul makes it clear when he says, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you speak the same things, meaning that you be on the same page. You can't have a church, somebody singing, what a fellowship on this side, and on the other side, somebody singing, I shall not be moved. You got to be on the same, speak the same things. And then he said, let there be no, not some, let there be no division among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. That's powerful stuff. Paul is going right at the heart of what's causing division in the church of Corinth. And what's causing it is much ado about nothing, but what really is causing it, it is selfishness. And he speaks about it. There are those who are arrogant, those who are puffed up, he says. And they carry this division. Not that they're trying to build up the church, but they are trying to build up themselves. And Paul is saying, let there be no division among you. Because when the church, hear me, brothers and sisters, the country may be divided, The country may be a blue state, a red state, but when the church is divided, it embarrasses the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It has no effect when people see us not getting along with each other. Boy, I'm a killer devil up in here today. And see, that's the strategy of the devil, because Paul speaks to the church of Corinth. When you read Corinthians, the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Paul deals with this church. This church had all kinds of issues. Marriage, divorce, taking one another to court. They had all kinds of issues. But the first thing he deals with is the division. He says, I hear from the household of Chloe that there's contention among you, because Paul, of all the issues that the Corinth church had, the first thing one he deals with is division, because if you got division in the church can't go nowhere. It's stymied. It's stifled. It is of no effect. The gospel is brought to a screeching halt when we are divided, when you got two sides pulling like a tug of war. This is my way or the highway. And it happens. I'm sad to say it happens. As you listen to me, it happens in your church. It's happening in my church. Because the devil gets into this thing. And his whole strategy is to divide and conquer. Even Jesus said, a house cannot stand against itself being divided. And Paul says, let there be no division. Let there be no quarreling among you. Because when you do that, you embarrass the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the word and the name Lord Jesus Christ, it represents his authority of all that what God stands for. We're called out of darkness into this marvelous light. And you're going to let, because somebody said something that you felt wasn't right, or somebody didn't invite you to dinner, or somebody didn't say hi to you at church, or somebody didn't speak to you in a proper way, you're going to let these things divide you and divide the church of the living God? Do you know that we are in the last days? If you cannot run with the footmen, how will you be able to keep up with the horses? Nobody said Christianity would be easy. But when we got Christ as our example and as our leader, we should follow him. This is from the pulpit to the pew. And Paul says, some of you say you were baptized in Apollos. Some say you were baptized in Cephas. Some say you were baptized in Christ. Paul is saying, is Jesus divided? And we get like that. You know, we follow pastors. I was baptized by Pastor so-and-so, and so I go by what he says. I was baptized of Sister so-and-so, so I go by what she says. And we form these groups, these cliques, because we feel that your baptism versus my baptism is much more qualified because of who baptized you. And Paul says, I'm not here to argue about when and where you were baptized or who baptized you. Paul says, I've been called by the gospel of Christ. He sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel with wisdom of words, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. I'm called to preach the gospel. I'm not called to be a referee. I'm not called to take sides based on this person and that person. Though we are many, we are one body in Christ. Let there be no division among you. Let there be no, you know, take it to the Lord. Forgive your brother. Forgive your sister. Don't keep fessing that thing up and getting people on your side and getting groups together. Because when you do that, you create factions in the church and you divide the church of the living God. And Paul says, is Jesus divided? This is us. I don't know about you, but we ought to be consumed with the love of Jesus. We ought to be consumed with his love. It's easy for me to love somebody who may disagree with me or agree with me. No, no. Your real love is tested when you can love that person who disagrees with you, because they're still your brother and sister. In my household, in the Thornton household, Carolyn, Courtney, George, and Justin, and myself, we don't always agree with each other, but we sure do love one another. And we are family. We ride or die because God has brought us together as a family. And even more so, not only biologically, but we've been baptized by the blood of Jesus Christ. How do we move from this division? How do we break up this fallow ground? How do we pull this thing together? I can't do it in my own flesh. Paul speaks about that. It is under the power of the Holy Ghost. Do not speak evil of your brother or your sister. Do not do them any harm. Do not tear them down. This is the language of Paul to the church of Corinth. Don't take your brother or sister to court. Embarrass the ministry or the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are called to a higher standard. Yeah, show thee, O man, what does the Lord require thee? To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. And he says, see, this is the greater commandment. We talk about we're Seventh-day Adventists, we're commandment-keeping people, but the greater commandment is that you love one another. And by this shall all men, all people in the world, even though the world is divided, they can come to a place where there is unity, where there's love, where there's harmony, where there's forgiveness, where there's patience, where there's understanding, where Jesus reigns supreme. Hallelujah! That's what Paul is saying. See, the devil, he comes as a thief in the night, seek to destroy, and he will take a little anthill, a little something, and build that thing up till it festers, and then the church of the living God is split right down the middle, and nobody gets the glory but the devil. And I have decided in my life, in my years of living, that I'm not going to let anything separate me from the love of Jesus. This is what Paul is saying. He said, it's not about who baptized you or when you were baptized. It's about the power of the gospel, of what Jesus is able to do in our lives. And he has called all of us, male, female, into this marvelous gospel. And what a difference he had wrought in my life and in your life. I pray today, brothers and sisters. Yes, I'm talking to Magazine Street Church. Yes, I'm talking to Pastor Thornton, but I'm talking to all of you who are listening. Let there be no division among you. We are not each other's enemies. The real enemy is Satan, the accuser of the brethren. And the only way we are going to get the victory over this, and that's why these series of messages, pastoral exhortation messages, they're about us moving to a different mindset. See, I'm convinced that there are some people who like drama. There are some people who like foolishness. Because let me be clear, and I ain't scared of y'all, but let me be clear. Sometimes people bring to the church what goes on in their home. And when there's home, when there's disunity in the home, they bring that disunity to the church. When there's discord in the home, they bring that same discord to the church. The person who cries shout the most or intimidate the most is the person who gets the attention. Oh, I know what I'm talking about. But see, we got to break every stronghold, every imaginary, every bondage. And that's why the song that we're going to sing that's going to come to you, the song is that we've got to ask God to break every chain, to break everything that is not like him, that is not like our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let there be no division. Let there be no quarrel. Let there be no one side versus this side. We are a family, family, family. Are we perfect? No. There's no such thing as a perfect church. But there's a perfect Lord. There's a perfect Savior. And he is our example that we should follow. Oh, this is who we should be. This is who we should be.
There is power in
power
Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
There is power.
Power
in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
There is power
in the name of Jesus,
to break every chain,
to break every chain,
to break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain.
Oh Lord, Lord, do it, Lord.
Break every chain. Come on, tell me, say, there was power in the name.
Sing it in your household.
Oh,
lift up the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
There is power. In the name of Jesus. Oh, to break every chain.
To break every
chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. To break every chain. Break every chain.
They said there is power.
There is power.
Don't you want that power today? Don't you want that power?
Come on, you declare it.
I want that power for my church, for my family, for my home, for my brother and for my sister.
There is power.
There is power.
In the name.
In the name. Not in Thornton. Not in somebody else, but in the name of Jesus. To break every chain.
Break every chain.
Woo!
Said to break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. There's an army.
There's an army rising up. Hey!
There's an army.
There's an army.
Rising.
rising,
rising up.
There's an army rising up, yeah, to break every chain.
God is developing a new standard. Do not operate out of your flesh. Operate out of the spirit. Ask God to help you to break every chain. In the name. In the name. In the name. Woo! In the name of Jesus. In the name. In the name. In the name of Jesus. Power. In the name of Jesus.
Just to break every chain.
To break every chain. To break every addiction. To break every problem. To break every division. To break every discord. To break every disharmony.
Come on, everybody say, there's an army.
There's an army. Hey! There's a standard rising up. There's a standard rising up. Hey, hey, hey. Oh, I feel it. To break every chain. To break every chain. To break every division. Woo! Woo! I hear the spirit breaking those divisions, breaking those chains, bringing brothers and sisters together again. The world may be divided, but the church must be united. Woo! Chains can be broken right now. All you've got to do is ask God to change your heart, change your mind. I hear the chains falling. The devil, you thought you had it. You thought you had this victory. But thanks be to God who giveth us the victory. Hey, hey, hey! I hear them. Right now, right now. Let's pray right now. Father, break every chain. Break every yoke. Break everything that is not like you. Let there be no division. Let there be no discord. Let there be no disharmony. Let there be no quarrel among the people of God. The world is divided. We see that. But the world needs a church that is united. The world needs a family that follows the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, break every chain. You're creating a new standard. There's an army rising up. We are brothers and sisters here at Magazine and in your church. We do you no harm. We cause you no harm. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you are my children, that you have loved one for another. Father, put it in us. Breathe on us anew. Cast out every idol. Cast out every demon. Cast out every stronghold. every imagination. Bring it down, oh God. This is us. This is us. That by all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love one for another. Bless this church. Bless this people. Speak to each family that is listening. Somebody's on the point of giving up and breaking up. Break that chain right now. In the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for this word. Oh, it may have been short, but God, I get it. Let there be no division. Speak the same thing. Speak the same mind with the same judgment. And Father, when you should come back and gather your children, may we hear you say, you've done what I asked you to do. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. For we ask it all in the worthy name of Jesus. Let all of God's children say amen, amen, and amen. Well, beloved, I thank you for tuning in to this broadcast today. Again, this is a three-part preaching series under the rubric Come Before Winter. After the election of 2020, what now? Last Sabbath, we spoke on hollow victory. Today, you heard the message entitled This Is Us. And next week, the message will be entitled Thanksgiving Weekend. The message will be entitled Y'all Need to Be Ashamed of Yourselves. I can't wait to preach that word, that God may bless us as a people as we continue to look forward to the coming of the Lord. May God bless you. Stay well. Stay safe. Wear your mask. Sanitize. Wash your hands. Practice social distance. Make sure you look out for each other. Look out for your loved ones. May God bless you. May God keep you. Is my prayer. Amen.